Hi, I'm Scott Stevens, lead pastor of Northway Christian Community. I'm excited you're here to listen to this message from our teaching team. I'm also excited that you are intentionally seeking to grow in your relationship with Jesus. By watching this message, our hope is your faith will be challenged as you learn more about who God is and how much He loves each and every one of us. However, watching or listening to a message is just one part of spiritual growth. In addition to being challenged by a message, I believe it's so important to be part of a local church community. At a local church, you can develop friendships and insights with other believers and also help to connect with those who are searching for God and not yet following Jesus. So, whether it is Northway or one of the other great churches throughout the Pittsburgh region, or if you're watching from some other part of the world, please consider taking this step toward being part of a local church. And if you do visit Northway, I want you to know that we are a church community that is passionate about learning to love people where we live and work and play. And there is certainly room for you at all of our Pittsburgh locations. Visit our website at northway.org for all the details. Hey folks, enjoy the message, and we hope to see you soon.
So happy Mother's Day, everybody. So glad that we can honor our moms at all of our Northway campuses today. And I particularly love that we're at each of our campuses, we're partnering with a ministry. Instead of giving you a flower that's going to die within the hour, right? It's great that we're giving away in your name something that's going to invest in a lifetime, not just a flower that's going to die. So also on Mother's Day weekend, here's what I know, is that there are some of you that are here today because your mom basically made you. Right? The only reason that you're here is because she just basically said, like, if you really want to make me happy, come to church with me. And so we understand that that might be the only reason why you're here. And I just want to say right out of the gate today, welcome. Man, so glad that you came with your mom. And many people have found Northway to be this really safe community of people where you can explore the things of God without any judgment at all. And so if that's you today, welcome. So glad that you are here. In fact, you're here on a day that we're finishing up a series that we are doing called Without a Doubt. So let me kind of catch you up, if you're brand new with us today, of where we've been in this series. So in week one, here's what we've been doing. We've been discovering and looking at doubts that many of us have, okay, about faith and Christianity in general. In week one, on Easter, here's what we asked. Was Jesus really the Son of God? Like really? Come on, was he really? Second week of this series, we ask the question, is the Bible even true? Can we really trust that the Bible is true today? Third week of this series, we ask the question last weekend, will God forgive my past, right? I know my past. Can God really forgive me? Because sometimes I just don't feel forgiven. And then today, we're going to get into another doubt that we have today. But before we get there, let me tell you what we've been doing. The last few weeks, we've been studying the 40 days after Jesus' resurrection. Because what he did with his life, when he resurrected from the grave, he actually addressed the doubts of his disciples. And not only just his disciples, it's recorded in Scripture that he appeared to over 500 people and he addressed their questions, their doubts, with not only the fact that he was alive, but he actually addressed them with his words and more teaching in those last 40 days. And so that's what we've been looking at in this series. So today, in part four, we're going to tackle a doubt that I think that many of us struggle with in life. And here's the question, is there a purpose to my existence? That's what we're going to dig into today. But before we get into answering that question, I thought I'd tell you about my recent trip to the mechanic, because a few months ago, I heard a little bit of a noise in my car. Right in the front, kind of right side, I heard this like grinding and this clicking. But me being me, I just sort of ignored it. And anybody else do this? You just sort of hope that it goes away. Maybe I ran over a twig or something. It's just going to work itself out, right? So Erica gets into my car the one day and she goes, "Oh my goodness, you have to take your car to the mechanic." So I take my car to the mechanic, and I try to explain the problem. He says, "What's wrong with it?" And I said, "Well, I'm hearing a noise in the front right side." And inevitably comes the question, right? You know the question that mechanics ask, I think, simply to like make fun of us later on with their buddies, right? You know the question that he asked me, right? Well, what's it sound like? And so there I am with like people around me trying to describe the sound to my mechanic. And eventually I get to the point where it's like, I say to him, well, when I pull out, it's like, anybody else do this? Right? I know I'm not the only one in our church that does this. When you're like trying to describe it, maybe to your husband, you know, when I hit the brakes, it's like, you use that kind of, you know, sounds to describe what's going on with your car, right? Now, I didn't want to fully like hand over my man card to the mechanic. So like at the end of that whole exchange, I threw in this little line, like, I think it might be the caliper pin. Now, if you know me, I know nothing about cars. I don't even know what a caliper pin is. All right, I don't know what it does, but I needed like to throw it in there that somehow maybe I knew a little bit, so I wouldn't get taken advantage of or something like that. Maybe I know a little bit about the problem, but in reality, I had no clue what the problem was, or how to go about fixing it, or how to fully even describe what was going on with my car. And I think that that is how many of us approach this doubt about our purpose in this life. See, most of us, when we get to the point of asking these types of questions, is what's the purpose to my existence? Why am I even here? What is my purpose in this life? We ask these types of questions because we're not even sure if we have a purpose. And if we think we have a purpose, we're not sure what it is. But what we do know is this, that something's off. We can feel it. We can hear it late at night when we lay our head down to rest. And we don't even know how to fully describe it. And when we try to describe it, we feel like fools talking with other people. We don't even know how to put it into words. We don't know how to fix this problem that we feel, that we just know is there. And most of us, like me, you just tend to ignore it. And you hope that it'll just kind of go away if we just keep driving faster and faster in life. We just hope that that grinding sort of makes its way out of there. But inevitably, when we slow down, when our head hits the pillow at night, we hear that grinding noise again and again. And we conclude that something must be wrong with me. When it comes to my purpose, I have to be the problem. And we look inside. I love what Pastor Rick Warren says. He writes in his book, famous bestseller, The Purpose-Driven Life. First page, he writes this: the search for the purpose of life has puzzled people for thousands of years. That's because we typically begin at the wrong starting point, ourselves. We ask self-centered questions like, what do I want to be? What should I do with my life? What are my goals, my ambitions, my dreams for my future? But focusing on ourselves will never reveal our life's purpose. The Bible says it is God who directs the lives of his creatures. Everyone's life is in his power. And in the same book, he uses a paraphrase of something that the Apostle Paul wrote, recorded and preserved for us in the book of Colossians in our Bibles. He says this: for everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him. The Apostle Paul is referring to the person of Jesus Christ. He's saying everything got its start in Jesus, finds its purpose in Jesus. And here we are in life, many of us searching under our own hoods, trying to look internally for the remedy of our purpose, thinking that we ourselves are the starting point for our purpose, that we ourselves might be the problem of not being able to find our purpose. And I want to tell us right out of the gate here today, everybody, you've been looking in the wrong place. See, your purpose is not about you. It never has been. And it never will be. Your purpose will always involve you, but it will never be about you. See, the 40 days after Jesus' resurrection, Jesus knew that his followers were still struggling with their purpose in this life. Even after everything that they had seen with Jesus, all the miracles, all the teaching, his death and his resurrection, Jesus knew that they were still struggling with their purpose in life, even after seeing the resurrected Jesus right in front of them. Up until his last day with them, the 40th day before he leaves them, these guys are still struggling. Take a look at what it says in Matthew. Now the 11 disciples, remember Judas is no longer with them now, they went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw Jesus, they worshiped him. But look at this, some doubted. Now, I don't know about you, but that actually gives me a lot of comfort to know that I am not the only one who struggles with doubt and purpose in this life. So here you have the disciples looking directly at the resurrected Jesus, looking into his eyes. He's right there in front of them. He's the one who showed them his scars, and they still doubt it. They're still wondering what they should do with the rest of their lives. And you know what I love about Jesus right here? He doesn't lay the smack down on them. He doesn't say, come on, guys. We've been over this for 3 years. Like, come on, give me a break. He doesn't do that. What I love about Jesus in this moment is he speaks directly to their doubt with some really strong words, his final words, in fact. Before he went to be with God the Father, Jesus gave them these words. So we're going to study two different accounts of the same exact moment. One's written by Matthew and one is written by Luke, okay? So Matthew, he records this. Now Jesus came to them and he said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Let's just stop right there. Can we all just agree that that's like bigger than Endgame stuff right there? That's like a ton of authority. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus. And what does he say? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. So Jesus, in this moment, he speaks into their confusion, to their doubts, with a mission, with a purpose. And he reminds them of what he's already taught them. He says, listen, you're not going to have to go at it alone. I'm going to be with you always. The one that has all authority in heaven and on earth is going to be with them. It's the greatest co-mission of all time because it's co-purpose. So check this. Jesus not only gives us his mission, but he gives us himself to accomplish the mission. He reminds them and us that he's already given something to us, the responsibility to advance God's kingdom and a relationship with the king of that kingdom. And then check out this moment, now recorded by Luke in Acts 1. Same moment, different perspective, different words. Look at this. So when they came together, they asked Jesus, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, guys, listen, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And then when he said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. Could you imagine being there in that moment? Right? Jesus reminds these guys of what he's already taught them. He says, we've been over this. He reminds them who they are. He says, don't worry about all this other stuff that you shouldn't be concerned about, that you're not going to figure out anyway. Your purpose is to advance the kingdom of God wherever you go, right? That's what you're to do. You are to be God's witnesses about who Jesus is and what he has done in your life. And remember, you're not alone. I'm sending you a helper. His name's the Holy Spirit to accomplish this mission. The Holy Spirit of Jesus who will be with you to the very end of the age. You guys know me by now. I try to get, you know, some of these things that Jesus taught us into like memorable statements that we might be able to take out of here and just remember, oh yeah, this is what Jesus was saying. So if I could paraphrase what Jesus is doing here in this last moment before he ascends to be with the Father, here's what I think Jesus is saying to us. Just be you and do what I did. It's as simple as that. Just be you and do what I did. Recognize that you're a son, you're a daughter of God, and do what I did. And when it comes to our purpose, I think this is where many of us get stuck. Because you and I, we often tie our purpose to our vocations, to our jobs. And friends, that is a giant mistake. Because our purpose will always supersede a job. Jobs will come and they will go. If your purpose is your job, then what happens when you lose it? What happens when you retire someday? Your purpose is bigger than what you do for a paycheck. Now, your purpose will influence what you do and the jobs that you might look for, but your purpose is actually who you are in the workplace. Your purpose is who you are in the places where you live, where you work, and where you play. And Jesus is saying to his disciples and to us, now that you've met me, the resurrected Jesus, now that you're gonna follow me, your purpose has now changed forever. Right? See, follow me, just be you, and do what I did. My purpose, my mission has now become your mission. And personally, can I just say this to you? When I met the risen Jesus, like when I actually had an encounter with the risen Jesus, my purpose completely changed in life. Prior to meeting the risen Jesus, life was all about me. What can I get out of this? How much money can I make? After meeting the resurrected Jesus, I got on board with his mission for every follower of Jesus' life. And my life has never been the same. For 25 years, I've been pursuing Jesus and his mission in this world. See, friends, when I met the risen Jesus, when you meet the risen Jesus, you can't help but have your purpose of life be changed. So if you want to know what you've been designed for, if you want to know what your purpose is in this life, no matter the job, no matter what city you've been in, no matter what single or married, allow the Jesus purpose to become your purpose. Right? His purpose is now our purpose. So this begs the question, right? Well, what was Jesus' purpose? Right? So when we think about the purpose of Jesus, many of us automatically go to the cross, and rightly so. He came to die so that we might be free from our sin. But you know that there was a whole other 3 years of ministry in there, of his life, that we need to look at for his purpose. And it was so much more than just that one amazing moment. Because I believe when we read the gospel accounts of Matthew and Mark and Luke and John, we see some very distinct wheels of purpose. So go with me for 1 second back to this illustration of the mechanic. I want you to imagine that there's a car up here with me, all right? I want you to imagine that it's your car, your life of purpose. And when I read the gospel accounts and we allow Jesus' purpose to become our purpose, what I see is 4 wheels of purpose in Jesus' life and in his ministry. And what we need to do is to evaluate if one of these wheels is out of alignment. Maybe we're hitting a pothole in our life, right? Maybe the tire pressure is low and we haven't been paying attention to that particular indicator on our dashboard. We need to line up our wheels with his wheels of purpose. So when I read the gospel accounts, I believe I'm seeing four different distinct wheels of purpose. And the first one that I see is this: Jesus revealed what God is really like. Right? Think about this. Jesus said that whoever has seen him has seen the Father. Right? He also said that I have shown you many good works that have come from the Father. So if Jesus reveals what God is really like, he's putting God's character on full display for everyone who encounters him to see what God is really like. Jesus literally fleshed out who God is in front of us so that we might be able to experience him. In fact, if you want to know what God is really like, just look at Jesus. And if you've never done that, if you've never taken the time to read the gospel accounts, to do a deep dive on who Jesus is, and you want to know what God is really like, do that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, read about who Jesus is. So if we are to align our wheels to Jesus' purpose, because his purpose has now become our purpose, we need to do some evaluation at the mechanic, right? We have to recognize that we have a part to play in this. His mission, his purpose has become our mission. So through you and me, we have an opportunity to provide people where we live, work, and play a fresh and an accurate picture of what God is really like to our neighbors, to our coworkers. I love what Billy Bob says, right, around here. He says to represent Jesus, to represent him to anybody that God brings around us, to show them what God is like with skin on here today. We have that responsibility. So here's what we're gonna do every time. Each one of these wheels, we're gonna go to the mechanic. All right? We're gonna go to the mechanic. How are you doing at revealing what God is really like in the places where you live, work, and play? Do some self-evaluation. Check the dashboard on this one. Are you representing what God is really like? Is that wheel good? Or do you need to check the tire pressure on that one? The second thing that we see as you do a deep dive on who Jesus is throughout his life, the second wheel of purpose that I see is that Jesus reconciled people to God. Right? Sin has separated us all from God. And Jesus' death on the cross enables us to have a relationship with God to be restored again. See, Jesus said of himself, I came to seek and to save the lost. See, Jesus pursued people who did not have a right relationship with God. And he wanted to hang out with them, right? You remember when he called Matthew, he says, hey, follow me. Matthew left everything to follow Jesus. And what was the first thing that Matthew did? He threw a party, because that's what he was used to introduce all of his buddies to Jesus. How are we doing with stuff like that? How are we doing at introducing people to Jesus? You know what else we see in the scriptures throughout the gospels is you see Jesus meeting people's needs. In fact, he spent so much time with needy people, he got a nickname. It was the friend of sinners. Jesus hung out with them so much. So what does this mean for you and me as we rightly align our wheels with Jesus' purpose? What does this mean for us? See, Jesus has also given us the ministry of reconciling people to God where we live, work, and play. By the way that we live, by the way that we relate to people, see, we should cause people to want to be introduced to the one who gives us the hope that's inside of us. Do you, do I have that kind of compassion towards people today? Especially when we interact with people who don't know Jesus. You know, a great way that we can do this in our neighborhoods is to look for the needs of people and to actually meet them. It can be that simple, right? What if, without asking this week, you actually went to your neighbor and mowed his lawn without even asking? He needs it done. And what if you did it? You know, what if you offered to babysit for that young couple who hasn't had a night out for a long time in your neighborhood? And what if you offered to do it for free just so they could have a great night out? No strings attached, just serve them in your neighborhood. And when they ask you, why would you offer to do that? Why would you do this for me? Simply just respond, just trying to live my life like Jesus. And some of them might be weirded out by that, but some of them might be really intrigued. See, here's the thing. I want you to see the freedom in this type of life to serve people. It is not your job or your responsibility to convince a person to follow Jesus Christ. It's not. Leave that up to the Holy Spirit. That's His job. Our job is to simply care for people, to care for them so well, and then we're ready when they ask us why we would do that. So let's go to the mechanic on this one, right? How are we doing at reconciling people to God? In the places where we live, work, and play, how is your wheel alignment? Tire pressure okay on this one? Is there a dashboard indicator that this one might be a little bit off, pulling you off in a wrong direction? Let's check that tire, okay? The third wheel of purpose that I see in Jesus' life is this. Jesus demonstrated God's kingdom on earth, right? He didn't just talk about the kingdom. He demonstrated God's kingdom. Do you remember how he taught us how to pray? He said, God, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And I think that this is where many of us get caught in this purpose of life search. Because many of us, we get caught up in searching after our own kingdom, advancing our own little kingdoms, make as much money as I can for my little kingdom later on and for my kids' little kingdoms later on, without asking the question, but what about God's kingdom in my life? See, a good question to ask when we're feeling like this wheel might be a little bit wobbly and out of alignment with Jesus' purpose is that whenever we come to a purchase, whenever we come to a promotion, whenever we come to a career path or an opportunity, a great question to ask about aligning our ways with Jesus' purpose on this one is this: is it this about God's kingdom or is this about my kingdom? God's kingdom or my kingdom? So let's go to the mechanic again, right? How are we doing on this one? Tire pressure okay? Feel like it's aligned? If it's off, maybe take note of that because we're about to go to the mechanic with it. So lastly, when you look at the life of Jesus, here's the fourth thing that I see with his wheels all simultaneously operating in his purpose in his life is that Jesus reproduced disciple makers. You see this throughout his life, right? Remember, okay, Jesus, he taught the crowds, but he invested in only a few, 12 to be specific. He invested in them to make sure that his kingdom was going to advance in this world. Jesus poured 3 years of his life into just 12 people. Only 12. Many of us today, when it would come to our life purpose, if we would think that that is the way that we should do something, we would consider Jesus a failure, that his purpose was, it didn't work. But you recognize that you're here today because Jesus invested in only a few people at a time. That blows my mind. See, he passed on God's character, God's ways, God's mission to only a few people at a time, and he expected them to do the exact same thing in other people's lives. See, in the Great Commission, what did Jesus tell us? He said, teach them to observe, to obey all that I have commanded you. And so to align this wheel to Jesus' purpose in our lives, we need to ask the question, am I investing in a few? Am I actually doing what Jesus told me to do? Am I making disciples like Jesus did? Am I passing on God's character, his ways, his mission to a few people at a time, expecting them to do the same thing. And church, I need to call a timeout on this one. Because I feel like I need to say, like in my new role as discipleship pastor of Northway Christian Community, I need to say this. This is not your pastor's job. It's not just his job. It's not just the church staff's job to make disciples of all nations. This is the church's job. And I'm looking at the church. You are the church. You didn't come to church today. You are the church today. This is the purpose of every follower of Jesus Christ. Some of us just think that's for like the veterans of the faith. No, this is for every follower of Jesus Christ to make disciples by investing in a few people at a time. Friends, can I just tell you, that's what our Rooted experience is all about. If you've been hearing about Rooted, over 1,100 people have gone through this Rooted experience because that's what this is all about, investing in a few at a time, passing on God's character, ways, and mission. See, that's what small groups are all about. So maybe you should think about next semester or even looking at the small group connects that are coming up, right, to get connected into a small group. In fact, if there are some of you that have been following Jesus for a while and you're not investing in a few, maybe you should pray about leading a small group so that you can do what Jesus called you to do. And can I just then call another timeout maybe on parents today? Of which I am one, so what I'm about to say, it's like it's coming right back at me. Sometimes as the pastor, as you're getting ready to preach, God deals with you first. What you're about to say is like directed actually at me. See, here's the thing. We have to realize, parents, hear this. Hear my heart. This is so valuable for us and so worthy of our investment, more than travel sports, more than performing arts. And please, I'm not saying that those things are bad. My girls are in travel sports. But if we're investing more in sports and clubs and theater than we are in discipling our own kids towards Jesus' purpose, then our wheels are out of alignment on this command of Jesus. It's our responsibility as parents to make disciple makers of Jesus with our own kids, because no matter what field of life that they're going to step on, no matter what stage that they're going to come to in life, they should be first and foremost disciples of Jesus Christ, and they should know how to deal with that. So let's go to the mechanic on this one, right? How's this wheel? Is it out of alignment? Do you need to check the tire pressure on this one? See, I could spend an entire sermon on each of these four wheels of Jesus' purpose, but we're out of time for today. So I just want to leave you with one thing, a very practical step here today, because there's no way in 30 minutes that I'm going to be able to fix this for you. So here's what I suggest. I suggest that if one of your wheels, if more than one of your wheels feels out of alignment, then take your car to the mechanic. If something that I've said today has sparked something and you've heard a grinding noise inside of you, something has perked you, right? Then you need to take your car to the mechanic. And your mechanic might be your small group leader. Your mechanic might be one of the elders after our service. Your mechanic may be your pastor. Right? Your mechanic may be your friend who's a little bit further along in this spiritual journey than you, but I would suggest that you take your car to the mechanic and have a conversation about what you feel is wrong inside. And I don't know if you've noticed, I've tried to give you language today to describe what is going on inside of you. You might think this wheel of demonstrating God's kingdom on earth is out of balance, so let's talk about that one. This idea of investing in a few, that's where I feel like I need some work done. Have a conversation about it. Because here's the thing. Jesus tells us, followers of Jesus Christ, without a doubt, that our purpose when we choose to follow him And if something that I said today caused something inside of you, then you need to take it to the master mechanic as well and say, God, what do you want me to do about this issue? My encouragement to you today as we wrap down this series is to take your life to the mechanic. Let me pray for us. God, I thank you for the truth that we see in scriptures about Jesus and the way that he lived his life on purpose, on mission. And God, we want to be a church that joins him on mission. So God, in those four areas that we see in his life, would you help us to examine our lives and to get on board with his mission? Help us to do that today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.